In three past videos on interest, dividends, and Schedule D, I introduced these three tax reporting forms: the 1099 INT for interest, the 1099 DIV for dividends, and the 1099B for stock transactions. But in the real world, if you invest through a broker, you'll never see any of these forms, and instead, you'll get one of these. This is a consolidated 1099 from a broker, and today I'm going to show you how to read this statement and put its information into the proper places on your tax return. I'm the Tax Geek, and here are consolidated brokerage statements oversimplified. First, don't be intimidated by one of these statements. Regardless of how many pages it can contain, you usually only have to be concerned about the first two pages, and sometimes all the information you need for your tax return can be found on just the first page. The Consolidated 1099 combines several different forms in the 1099 series into one document, including 1099 INT, 1099 DIV, 1099B, 1099 OID, and 1099 MISC. We won't worry about the last two and focus strictly on reporting interest, dividends, and stock transactions, what you're most likely to see if you're a small investor. The top part of the form, like all 1099 forms, contains information on the payer and the recipient. Throughout this video, we'll be looking at this brokerage statement belonging to Emily Woodhouse and showing where each figure on the brokerage statement is entered on her tax return. If you're a little foggy on the tax consequences of interest, dividends, and stock transactions, you'll see frequent cards directing you to other videos, supplemented by links in the description. The figures on the first two pages of the statement summarize and total all the activity in the account. A figure on the summary page can represent one transaction, or it can represent dozens or even hundreds of transactions. All these transactions are detailed on the pages that come after the first two, and it is not unusual for these statements to contain upwards of 100 pages. This is not the case with Emily, whose investments are relatively simple, and her statement runs just a few pages. Looking at the first summary page, we see that she received some dividends, a small amount of interest, and she sold some of her stocks. She does not have complex investments, so there are no figures on page 2. If you look at each section of the first page of the statement, you'll find one section each for dividends, interest, and sales transactions. Looking at the dividends section, you can see there is one line for each of the boxes on a 1099 DIV, and the same is true of the interest section and Form 1099 INT. In the sales transactions section, again, you'll find much of the information that is shown on a 1099B, including the term, the type of transaction, proceeds, and cost basis. Most of the time, this is all you need to know to report security sales on your tax return. After the first two summary pages, you'll find detailed information on every sale transaction, giving all the detail you'd see on an individual 1099B grouped by term and transaction type. The same goes for dividends, listing the companies that paid the dividends, the date payments were made, and the type of dividend or distribution. The same detail is given for interest payments as well. So let's take the figures from Emily's brokerage statement and put them on her tax return. The total amount of interest is entered on line 2B of her tax return, the total ordinary dividends on line 3B, and the qualified dividends on line 3A. Since she has less than $1,500 in dividends and interest, she does not need to file a Schedule B. The amount of foreign tax paid is then entered on line 1 of Schedule 3, and the total from that schedule is entered on line 20 of Emily's Form 1040. Now on to the security sales. Emily will need two Forms 8949, one for the covered, short, and long-term transactions, and one for the non-covered long-term transaction. On Part 1 of the first 8949, the total of the short-term transactions are taken from the statement. On Part 2 of the same form, the total of the long-term covered transactions are entered. Notice the M in column F. This indicates multiple transactions. For the long-term non-covered transaction, Emily goes straight to Part 2 of the second 8949. Since this is a non-covered transaction, she must put the details of the transaction from the details section of the statement on the form. If she had multiple non-covered transactions, she could either list each transaction separately or list the total and put an M in column F. But if she totals multiple non-covered transactions on Form 8949, she must send the brokerage statement to the IRS. This can be done by mailing the statement to the IRS along with Form 8453 or by attaching it as a PDF to an e-filed return if her software supports attachments. The totals from the Forms 8949, along with the capital gains distributions from the 1099 DIV section of the statement, are used to prepare a Schedule D, and the total from Schedule D is entered on Line 7 of Emily's Form 1040. Since Emily has both qualified dividends and capital gains, her tax is computed using a qualified dividends and capital gains worksheet. Consolidated brokerage statements can be intimidating when they arrive in the mail, but once you learn where to find the information you need and ignore what's irrelevant, they'll seem nowhere near as scary as they did before. And of course, this wouldn't be a proper Tax Geek video without additional information and resources on this subject linked in the video description. If you found this video informative, help more people find this video by giving it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you'd like to continue to get smarter about your taxes. Please share this video with anyone who could find it useful. Your questions, comments, and suggestions are always welcome in the comment space below. For announcements of new video releases and the occasional tax tip, you can follow me on Twitter at TaxGeekUSA. Thanks for watching, and I'll be back soon with more of your taxes oversimplified.